see on page 27 the list of league members and the various areas that they're responsible for, along with the officers who have supported them. And I suppose all I want to add really is to say thank you to all the members and all the officers for some really very hard work this year, and we're very grateful for it. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much. Okay, item 4 is the home safety strategy update. Bill?
Thanks, Chair. This, I will be brief because through my job, there's been a PowerPoint presentation for members in relation to this report. All I would say is, you know, members will recall that we reinvigorated and refreshed our home safety strategy in 2015 and adopted a more targeted approach to the delivery of our preventative measures across our communities. You know, my job will talk to you about how impacted that's been over the last kind of 12 months to 2 years in a great amount of detail. I'm going to draw you into one particular element of the report itself, which is to say how pleasing it is to see that for the first time ever, the Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service Officer, the number of active general dwelling fires experienced across Merseyside has dropped below 1,000. We've still, unfortunately, suffered 7 fatal incidents over that same period. Fact of the matter is, that is due to our targeted approach to home safety, that is due to the preventative work that our advocates and firefighters are doing in those communities. So without any further ado, I'll pass you across to Gary, who'll talk about it in a bit more specific detail.
Thanks, Chair. Members, obviously we spoke to you back in 2015 regarding the refresh of the home fire safety strategy. We were recognising at that period of time that our operational resource was reducing in terms of the fire engines on stations and the capacity that it gives us in terms of delivering on fire safety checks, and equally sort of the rise in trend in accidental dwelling fires in the home at that particular moment. So today's just a very, very short and punchy slides, but what the slides will indicate is some of the detail contained in the report. So just to remind everybody is how we target risk and vulnerability as an authority. So the primary sort of focal point is those aged over 65. So there was very much a trend around the fatal fires, and we were seeing a greater proportion of people aged over 65 who were dying in accidental dwelling fires in the home. And then there was various levels of sort of risk associated with that. So you're more likely if you were over 65 and living alone, and then equally if you had sort of adult social care needs such as mobility, dementia, and then know, sort of smoking and some behavioural issues around alcohol, drugs. So all of the factors were considered, and where we would focus our efforts and sort of develop our strategic alliances with key agencies such as Age UK, Dementia Champions and other partners to make sure that we get the right information coming into the authority to help us target and put our resources in the right place. I would like to stress that it is not done in isolation, but just the prevention team. Our operational crews in this last year have delivered 49,000 HMSCs. So during their work routine, that is like a significant sort of amount of effort. So they have a prevention block, and they're focused very much on the sort of the broad thrust of it, the over 65s. And 60% of the activity that the crews have done is targeting those particular areas, but we'll cover more in a little bit more detail. What is also being particularly pleasing is about introducing some new ways of working for our advocates, and I thought it would be helpful to bring some of the staff along today. So we've got Sarah, Gemma, Brittany, and we've got Chris from our call centre operation, so if you don't mind, you'd like to stand up and take a little bit of a bow. So in terms of our broad staff engagement principles, I think it's important that staff come along and see that, you know, our officers present information to you that they're able to go back into their colleagues and say, well, actually we came and heard it first hand, and they recognise some of that. In addition to the general work of the advocates and the crews, we've delivered over 40 campaigns. So again, working with operational response, so not impacting on training, we find gaps when we've got a couple of appliances spare, and we target them, so the appliances, the crews and the advocates come together to deliver those campaigns. So we don't do things in separation, we do it unified, and then we go into sort of that sort of neighbourhoods, what you're associated around selective licensing, so the poorer housing stock, or we do a theme around like Older Persons Day or an equality objective. So this, for example, this week we did a campaign on Tuesday, very successful, responsive campaign. So in the event of a fatal fire or a very serious fire in a home, we will always respond to the community needs. Interestingly enough, we've had a real strong focus last year on social media, and two of our champions of social media, we've got the chair of the authority, has become a very avid sort of retweeter of our messages, and Councillor Barbara Murray have done a lot for us in this last year, getting out the fire kills messages and other campaigns, so thank you for that. And Andy assured me from over to the tweet deck, Andy, as we're monitoring all of our activity, we're starting to see a greater reach of using social media to interact and engage with community members. So we're quite pleased that that's having some impact. In terms of what we talked about before, we introduced some new ways of working for advocates. We did a sort of engagement exercise, we asked them some questions about how they'd like to work, how they'd like to do things, and it was very much a strong focus on getting on the ground and doing those visits and engaging with people, and about less paperwork. So we examined how that was looked at, and we reduced one of our management information systems. So clearly over a 2 year period, if you look at April to March in 2015-16, so the numbers on each month, and if you look in this last year, you can see like an exponential growth in terms of the activity and performance, and so that's been about a 45% uplift in performance. So our advocates, the 24 advocates we have, are doing more every day out in the communities in Merseyside. And in terms of the agile working and being responsive, so they operate from four hubs. Our call centre manages their appointments. It's been a really sort of very pleasing piece of work around the staff, sort of getting on board and supporting those new ways of working. What that is sort of made a difference to us, this is the accident dwelling fires in the home. As the Deputy Chief Fire Officer alluded to, we've seen a trend go down, and for the first time in 2016-17, we've dipped just under 1,000. And we're never complacent, we know that there's more we can do. I don't think we'll ever eradicate completely, but I think we can do a little bit more if we remain focused. And how that looks in terms of stations, so what you'll sort of see here, probably our most densely populated station, that's an Old Swan, in terms of size, population size around 80,000 people, still has a significant number of accidental dwelling fires, but actually when you sort of look at the station at the lower end, it will support some of the objectivity around low level of risk. So we've got sort of Thornby, Feswell, Nimbleroes and Bellway at the lower end, and then everywhere else in between, so some of the sort of maps make sense in terms of how that works. Southport, we've got some challenges around Cambridge and Dewport, which we accept, and we're doing a lot to support the selective licensing areas there, and equally with an ageing population in Southport. So in the distribution, you can pretty much see that very often fires are linked to the deprivation, so in the dark blue areas, but we move on to a rural head, in the parts of North Liverpool, St Helens and Knowsley, and as we've alluded to before, Southport, Duke and Cambridge wards, and broadly in the lesser deprived areas we have less challenges. And again, how that map looks and the saturation of HMSCs over that. So the blue dots are the home fire safety checks. So what's really pleasing is to see that generally following the fire, there's usually a saturation of activity along it. So we shouldn't see just red dots on their own. We generally have to ensure that we follow up. In terms of the causes, clearly cooking features every day, probably almost 50% is still accidental dwelling fires in kitchens. So that is a focus for us. And there's other risks, and we work with our IET officers, our fire investigators, to look at emerging risks. Over the years, we've had issues around e-cigarettes, hair straighteners, not that I have to worry about those. scented candles, so I have to make sure that Mrs. Oakford's kept in check when she's going to TK Maxx to buy the scented candles. But nonetheless, we always look for what the emerging threats are, the emerging risks, and make sure that we try and stay on top of those to reduce risk. And again, staff are agile enough to be responsive to that. And one of the campaigns we've launched today is around knowing your neighbour. So for the next 2 months, we're going to have a real strong focus, because in the last reporting year, two of those fatalities, there was an opportunity potentially lost because a neighbour thought it was an alarm, but they weren't quite sure, they didn't call us. So we're going to have a really, really strong focus across Merseyside this next 2 months in getting that message out. And we've had some dialogue with Fire Kills nationally, and I'm supporting that campaign and taking it broader than just terms of the actual sort of the value of the home fire safety check and the education, so it's not just about fitting the alarms is important, but the actual education is important and what citizens do, so actually, and how they will help us to make our firefighters safer. So if there is a fire, when they go out, can they isolate the source? Do they close a door? How quickly do they call us? And those sort of measures, and do they have an effective fire plan, sort of mean at this stage that in some circumstances it reduces the firefighting action. So in some cases there's not. In other cases it's for the hose reel jet. And as I say, we're probably seeing less in terms of a whole lost and the cost of the housing providers and the homeowner and the distress by actually having that sort of that engagement exercise. So it's just the home fire safety check, the actual behavioural conversation, the actual sort of talking about lifestyle issues is probably equally as beneficial as to fitting the alarms and ensuring that they're working. And then finally, I think we'd all recognise that we went through a particularly challenging period as an authority in terms of the accidental dwelling fire deaths. So as we went through 3 years of increasing numbers, disrupted sort of that trend. So it's a 4-year low, but as we said before, we're never complacent. We always monitor, we review the causes of those fires, we engage with partners, Byrom, as an example. There's been extensive work with colleagues of Liverpool City Council, Coroner's Office and others following Mather Avenue, so how we can potentially prevent that again. So we work hard to try and sort of have that level of engagement. But again, you can see that we've gone from 16, 15, 16, and taken it down to 7 in the last report of the year. 7 losses of life, but nonetheless, it's an improvement on those from the year before.
Thanks, I'm only to say, Chair, the recommendation is that members note the contents of the report and clearly the presentation delivered by the engineer. I'm sure myself or Gary are happy to take any questions if there are any.
Okay, item 5 is the service delivery plan for the year 2016-17.
Chair, the purpose of this report is to request members note the performance of the service against the targets set in the service delivery plan for 2016-17, which covers the period 1st of April 2016 through to the 31st of March 2017. The background to the planning process has been reported to members on a number of previous occasions. It is set out in your report at paragraphs 3 to 11, which is on pages 55 through to 56. Appendix 8 of the report on pages 59 to 72 sets out performance during 2016-17 against all of our key performance indicators. The way the appendix is set out, you have the headline figures represented on two graphs. The first shows the monthly performance and the second shows the cumulative performance, and that's followed by a text box which provides them an analysis summary. Appendix B to the report on pages 73 to 92 provides a narrative update on our functional plans for the year, and Appendix C to the report, which is on pages 93 through to 98, explains the rationale behind our target setting process, which is also summarised in the main body of the report. If we can return to Appendix A, members, I'll take you through the top lines in relation to performance against the KPIs, and that will then be followed by a short presentation from Jackie Sutton, who will give you just some more detail. Page 60 shows the total number of emergency calls received, which at 22,465 was an increase of 780 calls on the previous year. Page 61 shows the total number of incidents attended, which at 15,438 was an increase of 1,366 incidents on the previous year total of 14,072 incidents. Performance against the specific incident types is set out over the following pages and explains that increase in more detail. Page 62 shows the overall number of fires attended, which at 7,346 is an increase of 177 on the previous year total of 7,169. The biggest increase was recorded over the bonfire period in October and November. This increase relates to antisocial small fires rather than primary fires, the difference between which I'll now explain. On page 63, you see the total number of primary fires, which is 2,597, is a decrease of 21 on the previous year total of 2,618. Now, as members may be aware, primary fires are those where there's an insurable loss, i.e. say properties or vehicles, whereas with the antisocial small fires, they don't have any value. So it would be things like rubbish in the open, skips and so forth. So that's the difference. There was an increase in the antisocial small fires, but we have decreased in the fires where there is an insurable value. Page 64 shows the total number of accidental dwelling fires, which has been mentioned previously at 991. Is a decrease on the previous year, and it is the first time ever that we have recorded below 1,000. And that is a real achievement, members. Bear in mind, 20 years ago, we were recording three times that amount. We were running around 3,000 dwelling fires over the calendar year. The narrative text on page 64 shows the numbers of fatalities and accidental dwelling fires, which at 7 is a reduction of 9 on the previous year total of 16. That was alluded to in the previous presentation. Clearly, every fatality is a tragedy, members. However, the reversal of the increase of the last 3 years is definitely something to be welcomed. That reduction is also reflected in the number of injuries, which at 93 is a decrease of 19 on the previous year total of 112. What you can be assured of, members, and again, as was alluded to previously, that we will be relentless in our attempts at preventing accidental fire deaths and injuries. Page 67 shows the total number of secondary fires, which at 4,749 is an increase of 336 incidents on the previous year total of 4,430. Previously explained, members, these are antisocial small fires which have no material value associated with. Page 69 shows the total number of special service incidents attended, which at 3,071 is an increase of 305 incidents on the previous year total of 2,766. There is a number of reasons for the increase, which include our responding to emergency medical response calls alongside North West Ambulance Service, and we did see the effect of extreme weather events such as storm doors. There has, members, also been an increase in the number of road traffic collisions that we attended. Page 69 shows the total number of false alarms attended, which at 5,021 is an increase of 385 on the previous year total of 4,636. Should be noted, though, members, of that total, 1,691 are false alarm good intent, which we do not want to discourage. Okay, so there is a dichotomy there, members, in so much as we do not want to discourage false alarms that are made with good intent, clearly. Page 70 shows our performance against the target of reaching 90% of life risk incidents within 10 minutes. And we achieved that on 96% of occasions. And also the time between a fire crew being alerted to the incident and booking mobile to an incident, which we achieved on 96.5% of occasions, and that's for that alert and mobile to be within 1.9 minutes. Page 71 shows performance against shifts lost to sickness absence for all personnel, which at 2.82% is a decrease and therefore an improvement on performance last year of 3%. Finally, members, on page 72, the chart shows the total carbon output from all of our buildings with a performance output of 86.3 CO2 per metre per building compared to the target of 130. The target is actually 112.6 rounded up to 113. I will pause at that point, members, and I'll ask Jackie to come and deliver her presentation, after which, if there are any questions, I'll certainly.
I'm Jackie Sutton, the Integrated Risk Management Plan Officer. I think you're probably going to hear some data and information pieces because of Gary's presentation and the chief's, but I apologise for that. If I don't say it, I'll get lost. So, carry on. this report is for the financial year from 1st of April 2016 to the 31st of March 2017 and includes highlights from functional delivery plans and benchmark summary performance indicators to give you a chance to scrutinise. We have had all the paperwork. The 39 functional plan action points for 2016-17, 7 actions are now complete. That includes all finance department actions, including development and production of the monthly report to your pension scheme. Now, we don't normally have this many carried forward. We've got 32 carried forward, and that doesn't mean that they haven't been worked on, they haven't been successful, they've just developed. And that was things like the ongoing work on development of the training and development academy, station merger project, procurement of a new website, development of a portal page for yourselves, reducing accidental dwelling fires and antisocial behaviour fires alongside partners, and continuing to introduce flexible working contracts. There's a lot of work being done on them. They've just evolved slightly and they've come back into the functional plans for 17-18. So these are the benchmark indicators that we report to yourselves, and obviously we bring in information from the local performance indicators, but these are actually the key ones that we work between. As you can see, this is what I'm reporting on the Dallas side. So when we've had green performance, which is achieved targets, we've got labour shifts lost to sickness. As you can see, it's a good reduction, 2.82% compared to 3% the year before. Uniform staff went from 3.46% in 15-16 to 3.18% shifts loss last year. Non-uniform staff stayed the same, 2.2 both years. Carbon output of buildings measures CO2 per square metre per building, and at 86.7% for 16-17, which was an improvement on 15-16, and it was 89.5%. of 999 calls granted within 10 seconds. November was the only month where we weren't green, where we slightly missed the target. We were within 10%, but for obvious reasons, the bonfire period. It's on average, it takes control operators 1.7 minutes to process a life risk call. This doesn't have a target, it's a quality assurance indicator only. 96.5% of occasions we're alert to mobile in under 1.9 minutes, our target is 95%. And all of these contribute to achieving our KPIs attendance standard of the first appliance to attend all life risk incidents within 10 minutes on 96% of occasions, preserving both life and property. This is some of the local performance indicator data which feeds into the benchmark ones, just to give you an illustration of where things have gone better in 16-17. This is the accidental dwelling fire group, so they all relate to accidental dwelling fires. As alluded to earlier, there were 7 fatalities in 16-17 in 6 incidents. 5 of the 7 fatalities were in accidental dwelling fires for people who were over 70 years of age. 2 incidents resulting in 3 fatalities involved electrical heaters as the source of ignition. 2 involved a dropped cigarette, and 2 were later fire calls, which kind of Gary was talking about before, about hearing your neighbours alarm, that sort of thing. Key performance indicators where we were within 10% of target. Very high numbers. 15,438 incidents attended. That's 1,366 more than 15-16. And this is due just to a general increase in most incident types. It's nothing specific. Total number of fires, 7,346, 177 more than 15-16. Again, no specifics and increase in most fire types except for accidental dwelling fires. And total primary fires, where the fire involves an insurable loss, 21 less than the previous year. Overall, dwelling fires are down 15.5%, and other building fires, which are all included in that group, are down 9.7%. Again, within 10%, total secondary fires, there were 336 more than in 15-16, but we were still within 10% of target. KB5s did achieve the annual targets. For quality assurance, only the total number of emergency calls are reported to you. There were 780 more than 15-16. We have had quite a few large incidents this year which resulted in a lot of calls. We had three incidents at the European Metal Recycling in the Seaport Docks, Ramondas in Prescott and the New Ferry explosion, and they did receive a large volume of calls. Areas where low performance indicators did not meet targets. Deliberate non-domestic premises, prisons are the main reason for this increase. In 15-16 we attended the local prisons 37 times, in 16-17 we attended 59 times. Deliberate vehicle fires, although motorbikes have been a recurring theme throughout the year in our work with the police and everything, they actually stayed quite consistent with 178 in 15-16, 188 in 16-17. However, car fires in 15-16 went from 277 to 351 in 16-17, attributable to criminality. Accidental small fires, there were 117 more incidents this year. All wheel bins, bins, loose refuse, that sort of incident. Special service calls. Over 50% were recorded as services not required when we attended RTCs. We had 605 calls to RTCs, but over 50% we actually didn't do anything. We just got there and services weren't required. The most frequently attended incident types were affecting entry and exit, lift rescue, flooding, new emergency medical response, and Storm Doris on the 23rd of February. We actually had 117 incidents that day. There were 5,021 false alarms attended, and the top repeat attendances are hospitals and self-catered sheltered accommodation. And as Dan alluded to earlier, the false alarm good intent we don't want to discourage. They can be things like a pan food out on arrival, but obviously we don't want people to not ring. The emergency medical response trial was introduced at Southport, Wallasey and Speak. We had 217 incidents in the year April to March. We attended 182 of them. We were involved in CPR on 68 occasions and we actually returned spontaneous circulation on 24 occasions. Home fire safety checks. 49,606 were delivered by operational staff. 61.3% of them were from the status reports which identify over 65s. 7,566 high-risk home fire safety checks were carried out by prevention officers. This is considerably more than the previous year when we did 5,249. With operational crews, protection officers and the old community risk intervention team which sadly ceased trading in December, we delivered 60,386 home fire safety checks.
People tend not to ring us directly for them, they normally, it's normally a referral from either of the two police or the same police or ambulance. And we're making a response when they believe the persons are trapped in the. So we may well attend, there may well be people will be trapped or medically. So if it can make the differentiation between mechanically trapped in the vehicle or medically confined in the vehicle. mechanically trapped requires us to create space. Like, we have to physically cut the person out of the vehicle using different techniques that we have dependent on the mechanism of the injury of the person. On occasion, when they are medically confined, that means they will be in pain and normally have back or neck pain, we could physically open the door and bring them out. But what the paramedics may say is, well, we don't want you to do that, you need to immobilise the spine, in which case normally we will have to remove the roof then in order to bring them out. But what's happening is, with the change in sort of medical view on that more and more, an instance where previously we would have had to cut the roof off to bring casualties out on the spine board, that is happening less now because paramedics are taking a probably a less cautious approach and they're allowing them to extricate the vehicle themselves. Primarily that is what is the difference between the... I think we need to be clear, right, we are not going to reduce that number of incidents because you cannot determine that until such time as you're
on site.
So I think it's important, a good question to raise, but that's it. In the same way as we are very unlikely to reduce the numbers of our responses to automatic fire alarms in self-gated sheltered accommodation, because we're going to have to go to them, and it's very unlikely we're ever going to manage them out, because we're not going to advise people don't have smoke alarms in their properties.
Yes,
Mr. The Fire Brigade Union have taken a position following their conference that they have supported an extension of the trial of emergency medical response to November, subject to a substantial payoff, and they will be submitting a pay claim on the 1st of June at a meeting with the National Joint Council. It is fair to say that the Fire Brigade Union's view, I think I'm speaking with some authority, their expectation would be 1% probably wouldn't constitute a substantial pay claim. Therefore, dependent on what the payoff is, and bear in mind, members, our assumption is a 1% uplift on the overall pay bill. The Fire Brigade Union have made it clear that they will withdraw from the emergency medical response trial if a substantial payoff is not made. What I will say is, members, that will not stop us as officers seeking to maintain emergency medical response and indeed rolling that out beyond the stations. What we need to realise, members, there is likely to be some industrial relations challenges that arise from that, but we will deal with that as we went there, as we went there.
I just wanted to say I'm very pleased what Diane has just said. Lead member on response, the evidence is there. I mean, 24 lives have been saved through CPR, through EMR. If that isn't a case for us to continue with this after November, I don't know what is. And obviously totally in support of what Dan has just now been saying. I've been extremely pleased with all the work that I've been hearing from Dave Mottram, and I had a meeting with him prior to this one on how it is all working. And, you know, there it is, it's in black and white. Very much for that.
Yes, I don't necessarily need a complex reply. It's just to say, those are our statistics. We also need to scrutinise this against the national picture. How do we stand? We think, those of us who do monitor,
recommendation that members approve the new equality, diversity and inclusion policy contained within the report on page 103. As members will be aware, that subject to significant amount of consultation, not only internally with staff, but the representative bodies and with a number of forums outside of Merseyside, which has resulted in the creation of the policy itself. I probably need to say no more than that, Chair, and open to the questions if there are any.
Set out in paragraph 5, and officers can apply for exemptions where those sorts of criteria apply. And this report is setting out for you the number and type of exemptions that have been approved over the course of the year, along with the departments that are mainly applying for those exemptions. So at paragraph 9, you'll see table 1, which gives you the reason for the exemption and the cumulative value of those. And then at paragraph 10, at table 2, it explains the different departments and the number of approved exemptions from standing orders alongside. There is a slight improvement since last year, although we're still looking at big numbers, but we've identified two departments mainly. And there are good reasons for these numbers. One being workshops. There's a number of low-value purchases going on there that basically accumulate over a period of time. And the procurement team are working very closely with workshops to try to get a sourcing strategy for that, which we think will be in place very shortly. The other department is part of people and organisational development. And the reason for those exemptions is that there should have been a national framework for training in place. We're still waiting for that, so we've had to put local arrangements in place for some time, but we're hoping that will be on stream very soon and it will reduce again next year. If members have any questions, I'm more than happy to answer them. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Charlotte. Quite a detailed report, actually. Mm-hmm. Just the reasons why there's been the exemption made. Obviously, there's been some work set and that will obviously pay off for the future years. Any questions or can we make a recommendation? Thank you very much. Right, so next, what's the update on registration measures?
Thanks, Chair. Again, this report to provide a progress report to members on the station major project up to the end of April 2017, and the recommendation that members note the report. I'll keep this relatively brief, because the content of the update is contained within, other than to say work has commenced at Prescott. Draw you to attention to paragraph 9, which says all foundations, the ground beams have been laid, and the concrete slab has now been poured. That's on the 26th of April 2017. The chain walls for the approach roads in place and steelware has started to be put in place through the period of May. And we are looking at now a completion date for the new Prescott site, which is, upgrade members will be aware, is a fire station, police station co-located. And that work is looking to be completed in March 2018, and that is on schedule. With regards to Sorgall Massey and the proposals to put an application into build a fire station on West Willow, a revised plan application was submitted to Willow Metropolitan Borough Council on the 13th of March and formally validated on the 28th of March 17. Part and parcel of that application was sought to address some of the concerns were raised through the refusal of the initial planning permission. And as a result of that, we have reduced the overall size of the fire station by some 30%. By 30% the overall size of the site, the fire station itself by some 10%. Realigned some elements of the building itself, so it's considerably smaller. We've also significantly improved some of the layout of the site and landscaping associated with some of the concerns that were raised. That planning submission, we believe, is going to the planning committee on the 22nd of June, where it will be considered, and we will inform members subsequently with options available to us to refer to the regards to St Helens, a number of conversations have been had with Pilkington as well on the site at Canal Street. Subsequently, the initial site that was proposed had been withdrawn by Pilkington. However, Pilkington have offered us a further site which is not too far away from the original site at Watson Street. When we've looked at the analysis in regards to our operational response from Watson Street as opposed to Canal Street, it's actually a more preferable base from which to respond. So again, those conversations have been had and discussions are progressing nicely. We've also extended those discussions as part of our collaborative duty to Merseyside Police and North West Ambulance Service and